Next on Enviro Close-Up, Ken Cook and Grant Smith of the Environmental Working Group. Welcome to Enviro Close-Up. I am Carl Grossman with Ken Cook. He's the president of the Environmental Working Group and was a co-founder. And Grant Smith, he's senior energy policy advisor of the organization. Welcome, guys.
Great to be here. Thanks for having us.
Thanks for having us, Carl.
Now, on your website, you explain the mission of the Environmental Working Group, starting with, "Our mission is simple, to empower you with breakthrough research to make informed choices and live a healthy life in a healthy environment." Wow, that's very daunting, that task, is it not? Perhaps, Ken, you can comment on that.
It is daunting, especially in today's world, right? The more we learn, the more daunting it seems. So we try and break it down in a couple of ways. Our scientists and our experts work very hard to come up with science-based but plausible, actionable things people can do. We know that public policy is slow. In some ways, it's non-existent these days when it comes to protecting us from environmental harms in the environment across the board, from contaminants in food to pollutants in tap water, bad air, loss of wildlife, and so forth. It is pretty daunting, as you say, but there's an awful lot we can do for people by way of advice, tips, straightforward shopping, assistance, all manner of things that people can take some agency on their own, considerable agency, to do the things for their own protection and their families that you really can't wait for the government to do. It takes forever to issue a drinking water standard. It takes forever for government to regulate pesticides. In our energy situation now, there's powerful pushback from vested interests to slow down the progress in green energy, but there are steps that individuals can take. That said, we are not all about individual action and market power and so forth. These are important elements. We don't want to leave any tools unused if we can get access to them, but we do not want to give up on holding government and corporations responsible. That means we have to hold politicians' feet to the fire, and we give people tips for doing that. We help them learn how to do that and take that type of step on their own. And then we also call out companies that are behaving badly, causing environmental problems, pushing back against clean energy and so forth. So it's a combination of things that we try and make it a little more plausible, a little more doable, a little less overwhelming. We want progress, not paralysis.
Now, on your website, you speak of areas of focus. And one, it's titled, "Putting an End to Coal, Oil, Natural Gas, and Nuclear Power." And it goes on, "Energy from fossil fuels and nuclear power, dirty, dangerous, and obsolete. These energy sources have no place in the clean energy revolution. From wind to solar and other renewable energy sources, the clean energy revolution is here, and EWG is helping pave the way." Grant, can you expand on that? And it's interesting to me. I mean, some environmental groups, not that many, but a number, have accepted the baloney that nuclear power is a green energy source, renewable and so forth. What would your reaction be to that point of view?
Well, we would oppose it outright. Obviously, You have enormous amounts of waste generation. Some of this waste, you know, will be toxic for a few hundred thousand years. And the public will pay for that, not the industry. Technology has been a financial disaster from the beginning. You know, $150 billion in cost overruns in the first generations built, $50 billion in canceled plants that ratepayers had to pick up. Then we had the second round of subsidies during the deregulation phase, around $110 billion recently, you know, four states or so. Another 15, now the DOE is going to subsidize more, the $6 billion. And these take enormous amounts of money, public money, in the design phase and the construction phase. The construction risks are shifted to the public. And then there's decommissioning. And then there's the attempt to manage this waste for basically forever. And, the public will be saddled with those costs. Secondly, when you move to renewables, when you move to variable solar and wind, you need a flexible grid. Battery storage provides that, that responds in milliseconds to changes in power supply. Nuclear is not one of those. It's a very cumbersome and expensive technology. And it's not a very resilient technology, and it's getting less resilient as climate change takes hold. Many of these, the majority of nuclear plants are susceptible or soon to be susceptible to high water stress, water being too hot, which has already occurred, but will be more frequent, to cool the plants, not enough water. We've already seen, Hurricane Florence, in North Carolina, for instance, where Duke had to shut one of its nuclear plants down before the hurricane hit. There was a lot of flooding. You're lucky there wasn't a serious accident. And then these things take a week to start up, 4 to 7 days. And with respect to every aspect of financial resiliency, flexibility, it's just a losing technology. And that applies not only to these larger traditional 1,000 megawatt units, but also to these modular units, where, NuScale is the only one that's moved along pretty far in NRC approvals, and that won't even be available probably, to the end of the decade. They've already had $3 billion in cost overruns in the design phase. So this technology is just a huge albatross around the energy transition and a huge financial burden to ratepayers and taxpayers.
It gets in the way too, right? We have these old, outdated technologies that are squatting in the way of our energy future. The longer we keep these nuclear power plants going, the longer we keep coal plants burning, the more often we try and build pipelines to bring natural gas to these generators that we turn on when we in high energy usage moments, these peaker plants, so-called. The more we do that, the harder it becomes to really move strategically toward a truly green renewable energy system, because they're in the way. They're occupying the energy supply that could be occupied by safer, cleaner, greener technologies. And nuclear is the worst, of course. I mean, look at Grant and I joke all the time that, for about $1 billion, you get a really nice set of drawings, right? Whereas in the design phase, whereas think what $1 billion could buy in any state right now, installing rooftop solar, even with batteries, you'd have jobs created all over the state, not in one place where the plant is. You'd have electricity being generated within months, not within years. And the cost overruns, the delays. I mean, this is, if you were a homeowner and someone came to you, well, maybe you have had this experience, but a homeowner and your contractor came to you and said, it's going to cost $100,000 and it's going to take 2 years. And then they came back and said, well, you know, actually it's $200,000 and it's 5 years. And then they came back and said, well, actually it's $400,000 and it's 8 years. You'd be looking for a new contractor. Well, we need to look for new contractors just in general in Powering America. And we really don't need applications from the nuclear industry. They've worn out their welcome. They've blown every deadline. They've blown every budget. And on top of that, they leave us with this mess. Grant mentioned decommissioning. I'll just throw one other point in there. It seems as if about the average cost to decommission a plant when it's lived its useful life is about $1 billion. $1 billion just to decommission it. And you're left with the waste. You still have to deal with the waste, which we, you know, we have to guard for 100,000 years. We can't even repair bridges. Do we really think that in 1,000 years from now, we're going to have, you know, vigilant guards watching over this giant piles of lethal waste? Of course not. But the industry doesn't care. They'll, you know, they'll have cashed their checks by then. So that's the other problem with it. It's just sort of evolved into a con game to keep the nuclear industry occupied. And of course, utilities make a lot of money when they spend on capital expenditures. That feeds right into their profit model, and they get, you know, 8, 10, 11% on top of whatever they spend. Why not build big plants if everyone's on the hook to pay for them? So it's lots of problems with these old technologies, Carl.
Let's get to some of the, what you title, other areas of focus. PFAS chemicals, you describe them as they're widely described as forever chemicals, but they're ubiquitous on the frying pans. And speak, if you would, either of you fellas, on the PFAS chemicals.
Yes, these are the per- and polyfluorooctyl substances, alkyl substances, rather, that are in the family of the chemicals that were used to make Teflon, were contained in Scotchgard. These miracles of modern chemistry that had these unique properties to shed water and oil. Unfortunately, these chemicals were developed and brought into the world, kind of like nuclear, before we really thought through all the consequences. And the consequences that became clear in the 60s inside the companies weren't made public until 30 plus years later, when EPA began nosing around. And those problems are, these chemicals almost never break down in the environment. That's why they're called the forever chemicals. Sunlight doesn't break them down. Oxidation doesn't break them down. Microbes don't break them down. An internal document in the industry said that they exist on a geological timescale. So they're around a long time. Secondly, they build up in people and in basically in the animal world, but they're ubiquitous in the environment. They're in everything from algae to polar bears. They're all over the world. They spread very quickly because they don't break down. And then, you know, the worst thing in some ways is the added combination. They are very toxic, which the companies also know. DuPont knew that. 3M knew it. Other companies knew it decades ago. They kept making it anyway. It's been linked to cancer, been linked to liver problems, been linked to endocrine disruption, interferes with the efficacy of vaccine. It's a really weirdly wide range of toxic chemical effects that you don't normally see. So there's lots of it released into the environment. Spreads everywhere. It's in every newborn baby in the United States. By the time they're born, they have this stuff in them. It's toxic and it doesn't break down. This is, you know, this is our era's chemical nightmare. If Rachel Carson had known about this at the time, she said, she would have said, well, let's hold off on DDT because I got a real story for you here. This PFAS stuff is really bad. So we've been working on it for 20 years. We were the first national organization that paid attention to the news coming out of West Virginia and Ohio about the contamination near the DuPont plant. There's some great films about it. There's a documentary called The Devil We Know. And then Dark Waters is the Hollywood version of what really happened when a crusading lawyer named Rob Ballot, a corporate defense attorney, decided to defend a farmer and then entire towns of people in West Virginia who were poisoned by DuPont for decades. And DuPont knew it was doing it, knew it was causing the pollution, knew it was in people, knew it was in their tap water, never told them.
Well, and then you have a general category of chemicals, toxic chemicals is the category on your website. And you note chemical companies aren't required to test chemicals for safety before they go on the market. We, the Environmental Working Group, offers resources to help you make better, safe decisions. And a lot of your activity, a lot of your work involves illuminating all these dark areas, speaking of dark waters, informing people. Please speak about how you inform people about these dangerous chemicals in general.
No, happy to. It is a disturbing situation. We really, when it comes to industrial chemicals, things that are used in consumer goods, cosmetics, some just a wide range of categories of modern life, really. The chemicals that are used to make those products don't go through a rigorous pre-market safety test, and neither do the final products if there are multiple ingredients in a product like in makeup. The government just doesn't have the authority to do that. Industry has fought back very effectively against any attempts to strengthen that authority. So what do? Well, we do our best to try and learn what can be learned about these chemicals from information that may be submitted to the government. Often not required, but it is submitted. Other regulatory agencies around the world where the laws are more protective, we get information from those sources, Carl. And then finally, we look at the scientific literature, independent research that's done by university scientists, regulatory agencies, and others may not immediately lead to a regulatory outcome, but it sends a clear signal about where these chemicals might be found in nature, including in people. Provides tremendous information in many cases about their toxic properties. And what we then try and do is fashion advice to consumers. Here's how you can avoid these exposures in your home, in what you eat, what you put on your skin, how you clean your car, pretty much every walk, every aspect of modern life. We have some advice to help people avoid the toxic chemical exposures. And you can do it without giving up modern life entirely. There are often many options, and thanks to pressure from consumer organizations like EWG and steps by companies that are trying to do the right thing, there are more and more options available all the time. But again, I really want people to know that even as we're giving people advice for them to protect themselves, we're expecting the government to step up and do its job, right? I mean, why are these companies allowed to have PFAS chemicals or, everywhere dumped into streams and used at airports in firefighting foam, which wasn't needed? And it ends up contaminating people's drinking water. Why are we letting personal care products come to market without adequate testing? Why are we, allowing pesticides to be used in the way that they do, that they end up in our food needlessly? Basic questions, when you ask regular people, they'll say, yeah, what's up with that? Well, what's up with that is the industry has overpowering control over these decision processes. And as a consequence, a lot of bad stuff happens and the government doesn't have the backbone or the political clout to push back. That's one of the ways in which we come in and say, look, we're going to hold the government accountable. We're going to keep politicians' feet to the fire to do their job. But while we're doing that, we're not going to insist that you wait for government to act. If there's something you can do, if you can buy a product that's safer to clean your house, safer for protecting yourself from sunburn, or better for your family's health in terms of their diet, and reduces toxic chemical exposures, we're going to give you that advice.
Also on your website, and perhaps Grant, you could speak to this, the urgent battle, and you use the word advisedly, the urgent battle to save the climate. The Environmental Working Group's activities on this this fight, this urgent battle, Grant.
Well, we've this is examples. We intervened in the rooftop solar fight, net metering fight in California and in North Carolina against Duke with their proposal. This is an enormous battle. It's been going on. You know, the utility industry has worked diligently for the last decade to undermine the ability of folks to put solar on their roofs, making it too expensive, you know, slapping massive fees on, which PG&E and other utilities in California are attempting to do. Duke is doing, proposing something not as horrible, but pretty similar in North Carolina. The issue is not only when people invest in these things, they're going to save money. They're also going to make the system much more resilient. They're going to displace the need for building these really expensive transmission lines coupled with storage. You're creating a much more resilient, flexible system. And, you know, in places like California, where you have, you know, almost 1.5 million people with solar, and many of those with storage, you know, their firms, businesses are aggregating these into virtual power plants so they can dispatch, you know, storage when they need to into the grid, or have the house powered to reduce demand from the grid. This can displace gas-fired plants, for instance. So there's an enormous potential out there with energy efficiency, of course, demand response, storage, solar at the local level, to create a much more resilient, affordable system. And of course, you know, this is also coupled with environmental justice and economic justice with respect to access to this technology. And, you know, it's not this cost shift issue. I mean, the cost shift is a red herring, if you ask me. For the most part, if you look at, you know, the benefits to the system of solar, where, for instance, in California in 2018, the organization running the transmission system there said that over $2.5 billion was avoided because of solar and energy efficiency investments. And these guys are pretty much ignoring those benefits and just talking about, well, you're shifting, the rich people are shifting costs to the less fortunate folks because they can't afford solar. Well, the issue is access. Provide access and actually look at the full array of benefits to the grid. One of the things they haven't done at all is look at the benefits of resiliency. If you're going to avoid a blackout because, you know, your commercial buildings, your economy is still running, you can save hundreds of millions of dollars just by not having the power go out. And this hasn't been very well incorporated into the assessment of the benefits of solar. In California, you know, I was very surprised at the extent of the utility influence. I'm used to that in Indiana, of course, with, you know, our commission being kind of captive, our legislature being kind of captive, but the influence in California of PG&E, for instance, is just absolutely enormous. And it's a huge detriment and drag to the economy. It's a huge drag to affordability, which is becoming increasingly important, you know, with people being able to pay their bills. just getting by. And, you know, going to a distributed system, a decentralized electric system, where you place an emphasis on that, obviously we're going to need these utility scale resource, you know, renewable resources as well, but it would make a huge difference. The other, I think on the, particularly within the next 5 years or so on the East Coast, I think offshore wind is going to have a game-changing impact. And the job growth and economic growth, tax base increases will really stimulate the economy, you know, from the Mid-Atlantic all the way up to Maine. And the potential is so enormous. These utility companies are hedging now around modular nuclear power. Duke is doing this with their carbon plan proceeding in North Carolina, for instance. They want to essentially be able to lock in modular nuclear power now in these proceedings to get the commission to say, yeah, this is a reasonable thing to do. And there, nobody even knows the cost. You never know the cost of a nuclear power plant until it's done. And it's probably more expensive than they say that it is anyway.
The nuclear industry, but the utility industry in general, their main worry is that for the first time they have competition, which is from their customers, as Grant always reminds me. You know, if I'm putting solar panels, which are increasingly affordable on my rooftop, or we're putting it on the school down the way, or above a parking lot, that's just removing more demand from the grid. And that means removing, in many respects, profit from these companies. They've been monopolies for a long time, really, right? One set of wires, we don't have competing set of wires coming into a community. We have natural monopolies. Well, that's all disrupted and changed if you can put solar in a distributed context on rooftops or, you know, vacant lots in cities, on apartment buildings, and add in battery storage, which is also getting increasingly affordable. That's very threatening to these utilities, and they're going overboard to try and make sure that that doesn't grow too quickly. They want to control the power. I mean, that's the thing about the first rule of monopolies is preserve the monopoly, and that's what a lot of this fight is about. So, in the context of climate change, there's a lot that's happening, playing out right here at home, and is a kitchen table issue now, which is, do we want to have a future of distributed energy where people are investing where they can in their local communities? They're more resilient, more affordable, not subject to the price spikes that come with fuel like natural gas. Is that what we want, or do we want to operate as if it's still 1910 and we have natural monopolies that we're going to just let run the show? And our argument is no, it's these technologies are disruptive enough. It's time to rethink absolutely everything if we're going to save the climate.
Thanks so much, Ken and Grant. I mean, we've not even gotten into how the Environmental Working Group works. I mean, broadly speaking, how you got started. So we're going to do a second show. So this has been part one on the Environmental Working Group, and next program, Environmental Working Group, Part 2. I'm Carl Grossman. Thanks for watching.